everybody. So I'm Alcione Mora, I'm an archive scientist, and I will try to give you some user or perspective on using the Gaia archive and the data. So, okay, good. So, well, I will give some introduction, and then the bulk of the talk may be boring for you. I hope it is not, because I hope you discover new things. One thing that we found after talking to the users is that people don't realize what do we have in data release one. So people just went for the CSVs of Gaia source, TIGAS, and afterwards they realized there is a whole realm of additional stuff in the data release, so we will try to explore that. Then some hints on where you can find additional documentation to keep working, and other interfaces, because the Gaia archive is not the only one around. A brief overview on the hands-on sessions, and that's it. So the introduction, we can think of the two big ways of working with the Gaia data. You can call it the traditional and the new, or whatever, we just call it the traditional and the Gaia archive one. The good thing is that there is no correct answer. I mean, whatever it works for you, whatever it allows you to do your science and write good papers, this is the correct approach that you need to take. Having said that, the traditional workflow which we can say bring the data to the code, so I get everything, so I download TIGAS or I download Gaia source if I need it, I ingest it in my local supercomputer, I talk to my database guru so I can do a cross-match with other gigantic data set, and then I do my science. This is basically the traditional approach. What the Gaia archive allows you to do is to bring some of your code to the data. This is a paradigm, it's not just an answer, it's an objective. So by creating the Gaia archive, we believe we are working towards that direction. So the idea is that if you do some clever selection of your data, the first thing that you gain is reproducibility. So something that we will see in the hands-on sessions is that we can reproduce Anthony Brown's data release one papers plots perfectly, because they are based on ABQL queries. So everybody can reproduce the results at all times. So that's one of the big advantages that I want you to bring from this meeting. You can also do lots of refinement. You can do use built-in cross-matches. You can use the engine that is within the archive. You can do simple computations, histograms, sharing. And in the end, when you really have a small data set, so real data reduction, so not petabytes, gigabytes, then it's when you do your science, when you have filtered them appropriately. So the Gaia data, it has been repeated a number of times, but where do we have the data? It is here, so at ESAC we have a copy, but there are more. The different partner data centers, I hope I didn't forget any of them, but they do have copies of the Gaia data in different formats. From tab to supercomputing formats, they are around. And there are many other copies by affiliated data centers, enthusiasts, CSV files circulating via Twitter, whatever. So we have the astrometry and photometry tables, so TIGAS and Gaia source. Then we have variability, cross-match, some external catalogs. And the additional value that Jesus presented that we provide at ESAC is what we call Tab Plus. So we have a database, so you can really upload your results or your data or your catalogs to our user space. It can be shared, it can be cross-matched. So this is the bulk of the talk. So, well, for those that have logged into the archive, this is the general interface, and then you get to that web page. For me, it's super friendly because I spend a lot of time working on that. Probably for you, it's not, but my advice is, please, if you want to work with that, forget about the simple form as soon as you can, as soon as you have learned what it has to offer, and move here, because this is where things happen. Second thing is, there are lots of tables, so not just Gaia source, not just TIGAS source, there are lots of them, and in principle it can be confusing. But there are ways to learn what is going on. So if you click in any of them, you have a basic summary of what is in there. If you click any column, you also have some information. And finally, if you click on show me the data, we can start exploring, which is what we can do now. So if we are exploring the Gaia source, so the main table in the in Gaia Tidal Data Release 1, each row, so each entry is one object. So that's what we have. We have different columns, we have units, we have a link to the data model. So if that description was not enough, we have a much bigger description, more updated, which is available. So now, what's in the Gaia source? So there are lots of fields, and first thing is, okay, it's confusing. So we have source ID. This is the key identifier unique for each of the sources. The first thing you need is to learn what are the source IDs in which you are interested in. We also have the capability to do random selection, so if you just want to analyze the first 1,000,000 objects or the first 10 million objects, that can be easily be done. And the names can, they look funny, right? I mean, it's not UX Orionis, it's not Vega. Why those numbers? So there is a reason. One of them is that you have hill peaks information in there. So just by knowing how the source is named, you can automatically reconstruct maps, which is very, very handy. We have, of course, positions, fantastic positions, the best for 1 billion objects, parallaxes, only for the TIGAS samples. Important thing, all around the Gaia tables, we have null values. Null values, not only for parallaxes, for other columns, they are very good at refining. If you are looking for parallaxes and you don't have parallaxes, you can select by not having them, and automatically your query runs much faster. Well, correlations, so covariances. Something that I have seen is, okay, I got the parallax, I got the radar velocity from Rave, I put everything in XYZ space and do everything like that, don't care about the errors. Well, there are lots, the correlations can be very large between the different astrometric parameters. So take a look at the covariance metrics, you see on here, close to one, they can really be important. So we also include galactic and ecliptic coordinates, but only for positions, and we have not done an error propagation for of the covariance matrices. You will need to do it yourself if you want to work in those reference systems. There is also some funny statistics which are very nice. They tell you whether all the observations were concentrated in particular in certain directions in the sky. They can tell you about the homogeneity of how different sources, how a given source has been observed. There is some elusive thing called the excess noise. We will learn about that in the astrometry splinters, and we'll learn how is this important. But the good thing is that some of them, there is some metrics that tell you when this excess noise, which is basically how good does my solution agrees with my observations, how are they significant or are they not. So we also have photometry, there will be also a plenary on that, and we work in the Vega system for Gaia Data Release 1, this is important, and we only provide errors for the fluxes. For the magnitudes, you have to compute them themselves with the recipes that are provided in the documentation. TIGAS source. So what is in TIGAS source that is not in Gaia source? Essentially, TIGAS source is just cropping Gaia source and just getting those stars for which five-parameter solutions, so parallaxes and proper motions, could be computed. So the two columns that appear in TIGAS that and not appear in Gaia source as the Hipparcos and Tycho identifier. Look that we have one or the other, but not both. Lots of questions on the help desk. Why is my Tycho star here, not observed? Okay, it was observed, but the Tycho identifier is not in TIGAS because it was observed in Hipparcos. This might look strange, but it's because of peculiarity of the Tycho catalog. There are duplicates in there, and it also tells you how the data was really analyzed. If we have Hipparcos data, we don't use the Tycho data. So it's also tracing what data we used in the reduction. We have also the quasars used for the rotation with the ISARF designation, and some flags telling if we use that, that quasar for rate ascension, declination, or both. variable stars, there will be a plenary, and we will learn a lot. But the first thing that strikes you when you are analyzing the variable stars is my data is spread in multiple tables. So we have right now 5 different tables for the variables in Gaia Data Release 1. We might have more tables even for coming data releases. Why is it important? Well, it is important because we need to adapt. We can build a gigantic table with different fields that are all important for a particular variability type, but then you'll have lots of holes in there. So the approach for DR1 was, okay, we only put the fields that we need for the particular star. So if there is some field for Cepheid, which is not for our alires, we separate them in tables. We also separate the light curve. So the light curve is separated from the global parameters of variables or for the statistical parameters of the light curve. And this is the reason why it is fragmented. It is convenient. In the end, you will get used to that if you need to use them. So for the summary of the variables, it's typically just a period, the fundamental frequency of that star and the classification. The light curve, so basically we have one entry per object and per observation. So this means that even if we just have a few thousand observations, this table has grown a lot. When for Gaia DR1 we include thousands and thousands of observations, this table will really grow. So basically what we have as our times, again, errors only provided for fluxes and magnitudes. There are some statistics regarding the light curve, so some statistics in the time domain, so about the time span, the duration, the observing time, also for the magnitude, so some statistics regarding how the data are distributed and many more. And for Cepheid, the information that we keep for Cepheid that are it's just the classification, so the classification only applies to Cepheid, same for our leaders, but in particular those kind of variables, they share a lot of in common, so those commons are common to both of them, so the period, so basically the phase. Additional statistics on the light curve, so very detailed about interquartile, ranges of magnitude, statistical variations. And also in the Fourier domain, so there are also information about how the light curve was fitted in terms of harmonic analysis. Pre-computed cross matches. We have talked a lot about the pre-computed cross matches. Why are they important? Well, for sure, because Gaia is just one data set. We need other data to do our science. So how do we do it? The first thing that we found is that the cross match is ambiguous. So this is the key point here. You can construct a super big table with the two mass counterpart, the wise counterpart, the ISO counterpart, because maybe it doesn't exist, or you cannot be sure to which it corresponds. So the first thing that we need to deal with is ambiguity. So what we need to construct is a pivot table between our catalog and the external catalog. We'll see that later. So because of having them pre-computed, we avoid lots of traffic. You don't need to upload too much to the archive. Too much is already in the archive. The cosmos is already in the archive. If you're interested in 1,000 stars, adding too much information happens in seconds. So just by doing that, we are being efficient. This is the list of the catalogs that are currently in the archive. It might increase for DR2. And we will have a plenary on that. But let me explain you about this multiplicity. So I went to the most vicious environment. So to the core of Omega Centauri. In the core of Omega Centauri, you have multiple matches. So this is an example for which a different in the Gaia star catalog, for a given star there, we have different Gaia sources that might correspond to that. So in that sense, we have one external catalog and different things that we will in Gaia that might be the best neighbor. We are not sure which is. And also the same thing. I mean, things are so crowded that we have a different, that for two different Gaia objects, it's difficult to say which is the best candidate that corresponds to that source. So we have two different types of pivot table, which one is the neighborhood table, another is the best neighborhood table. So the neighborhood is in case you want to do it yourself, because you might probably have a better idea in some cases of how the neighborhood is handled in Omega Centauri. So then you need the neighborhood table. Then we have not filtered, we just have a set of radius. We have applied proper motion, which is the important thing here. So in case you want to do it, you don't need to do the proper motion correction. It has been done for you. And then you can apply whatever metrics you want. We have applied hours, which is some score, and it's not just based on distance. Distance is a key ingredient, but it's not the only one. If you are lazy, or if you are just one astronomer in 99% of the use cases, you don't need to do that, because typically environments are not so crowded, and you can work with the best neighbor that has been computed for you. I did it for the, I believe it was Baades window, which is one very crowded region, and the difference was not that high. I mean, there are bad cases, but they're not so many. So, in case of the best neighbor table, you have an indication of the number of mates, which is what we discussed before. Sometimes we assign different multiple Gaia sources to a certain outside catalog best neighbor, because that's how it works. And you have a feeling of how many potential neighbors you have. Remember, this is one of the worst possible scenarios. And finally, the price. You are doing all of that. You are using that ADQL query that Jesus presented you, because what you are interested in is not the pivot table. You are interested in the additional data. So either it is photometry or it is astrometry, because you want to combine them, it is there for you. Additional tables that are also in the archive are the photometric zero points, again, Vega magnitudes, the Parkos catalog and Tycho 2, Hubble source catalog, and IGSL. Different questions have arrived about IGSL. I can't work with IGSL. The cross-match with IGSL is inconsistent with the cross-match in Gaia DR1. My source ID in IGSL doesn't exist in Gaia DR1. So IGSL, which was the initial Gaia source list, it was a key element in the production of Gaia Data Release 1, but the advice is don't use it anymore. It was good, it served its purpose, forget about it, start using Gaia DR1 table. Documentation. So the archive, as well as an interface, it also includes some documentation that might be useful, in particular the tutorials. The tutorials are part of the hands-on sessions that we will have this afternoon. The papers, read the papers, plenty of information in there. It's interesting to see how the people most advanced in using the Gaia data are sometimes the people reading them later. Also, the online documentation, it might be humongous, but in the end, there is lots of useful information that you might find there. The data model itself is difficult. We have lots of tables, lots of fields. It's difficult to interpret. It's in the data model. You can find maybe what you want. ADQL is a new language. It's, let's say, the steep part in the learning curve. But there are resources out there, so please use them. And also, we are there behind the Gaia help desk to help you if nothing of that works. Okay, so Gaia is not, the Gaia archive is not the only entry point. We have lots of entry points to access Gaia data. We have single object search engines like that at Gabo Ari. We have visual exploration tools like ESAC, the Gaia archive, Gaia Sky, large data sets visualization like VAX that will be presented in Splinter, already being used for Gaia data validation. Tab services, Gaia archive is not the only one, but you won't find Tab Plus. So the user tables, some functionality is not there in the other mirrors, but for many users, it's very okay to use them, and it was fantastically good. SQL if you don't want ADQL, CONSEARCH, cross matches, well. So this is if you are just interested in an object, so this single object interfacing in ARI works very well. This is another view of ESA Sky, which is something that has been developed at ESA, so you can plot not only TIGAS and Gaia in the future, but other catalogs. You can download the data. So the Gaia Archive Visualization 2 presented by André. Tap in ARI, tap in Visir. TopCat, which also is a client of TAP, is not a server, but allows you to do TAP's queries and plotting them. VAX, if you want to do interesting stuff with billion source data. Cross matches, okay, so plenty of that. Now for the hands-on session. So first thing that Jesus already said, please register. If you have not registered in the archive, if you didn't do it before, please do it right now, because it might be that you cannot work in the afternoon until it is propagated. It's the hands-on sessions are just a practical seminar, so you will have a script, 34 pages, and basically you progress at the pace that you want, doing the things that are interesting for you. So it's a self-study, and with the tutors from ESDC and the SOC are there to help you, but not to guide you. Basically, people just work at their own rhythm. If that feels uncomfortable to you, if you say, okay, I really know nothing about that, ADQL is scary, I want somebody to help me, please go to the ADQL guided tutorial that will take place this afternoon. There are two slots of 2 hours, 1 slot of 1 hour, and the slot of 1 hour in Friday also coincides with Adam Rees' talk, so take that into account when you are selecting the slot that is best for you. The good thing is we don't close the door. The door is always open. If you want to come there, if you see that you are in the Friday slot but you want to learn and you want to talk to us, come by all means, but we just give priority for the registered attendees. If there is room for you, you can be there in the room, no problem. The contents are the tutorials. We will reproduce some of the Gaia DR1 plots because, again, we can reproduce them. We do some exercise about how to compute proper motions with Sloan data, an example of a Jupyter notebook, how to access via Python. And also, if you are interested in something that is not covered and you have some doubt, don't be shy. Just ask us and we are there to help you with your science case. So, well, this is a flavor. So the tutorials will give you an overview of how the interface works and how to try to do it step by step. We will reproduce some plots from Anthony's paper, and we also see how to do it for DR2. This plot was simple to do it in TopCat, just a million points, but you can't do it, or it might be difficult to do it with a billion points in Gaia Data Release 2. You can do it in the archive. You can pre-compute a histogram in the archive and then download the histogram while it has been constructed. Some example of how to do proper motions with Sloan, and on accessing the Gaia data via Python. And just finally, to conclude, well, address of the archive and the help desk. There is a lot of functionality in there. It has been explained already, so it's what is called TAP Plus. There are lots of data in there. Please take your time to learn what is in there, because maybe you don't need to work that much, because some work was done for you. It's a step in what we believe it's a step in that bringing the code to the data paradigm. It's, of course, not over, but it's one step forward. And prepare for data release 1, data release 2. It has been said maybe the data is not available for back downloads in the future. Maybe even if you have 2 terabytes file, you cannot work with them in your laptop. So investing time in working with the archive might help you in the future. And add ADQL queries to your papers. In that sense, you gain reproducibility. Anybody can reproduce what you say, and this is a very good added value of that. Use it. If you don't use the archive, the development will not progress as much as we use it, and we have an active community of people asking for new functionality. and we are always ready to help you. And finally, some people asked us, how can we support Gaia? Because I am interested in Gaia, and I want Gaia to be extended. I want Astronomy in the future. So the best thing that you can do is write good papers, and then we will be supported. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alcione, and thank you for sticking to the time. So we have time for questions. Yes, over there.
There was already a question about the threshold on the computational power that... On maximum computational power that, or time limit that an end user can reach in terms of number of rows in or length of the query. So what am I to do if I have, say, 100 billion sources catalog collected in my backyard and I want to cross-match it with Gaia with some non-standard routine?
So if you are, I mean, if you are talking, for example, of LSST, this is a different story somehow. When those surveys arrive, we really need to think twice. Maybe we need to put a copy of Gaia in LSST, whatever functionalities. I mean, this is for sure something open for the future.
So, but there definitely will be maybe hundreds of projects on smaller scale than LSST, but they will still bump into this time limit. What the strategy is for that?
So, I mean, it is prepared to handle requests in the realm of millions of rows. This is what we currently have. So what we currently have with the infrastructure we have is that. There are ways that have been presented by Jesus of increasing the computer capability, because if you really want to do hardcore stuff, you need really more resources, and it's not clear the way forward to do it. So Docker, cloud computing, cluster computing, still not clear. Sorry.
Okay. Thank you.